when I was asked to give a seminar in this series, I rather rashly agreed to, and even more rashly agreed to lead something on the subject of scarce resources, about which I know really rather little. So the purpose of this is very much to be a seminar trying to provoke some discussion. It is certainly not a lecture because I'm not an authority in this area. It comes within the umbrella of is the planet full? I think I should let you know where I come from on that. I think that's pretty obvious. Yes. Okay, so we'll go home. That's where I'm coming from. Why do I take that view? Because of some of the things that might come up in the following slides. So I'm going to be talking about issues related to scarce resources. A lot of that's the problems, but I would like to look a bit at the solutions as well, because we don't just want to become depressed. It's about population. Is the planet full? I presume you mean full of humans. So very vague plot of population against time, deliberately with no scales on, although I suppose we've just been given that, you know, in 2000, beginning of November 2011, here we are at precisely 7 billion, apparently. The population is increasing, we know that. It's increasing perhaps not as fast these days as it has been at some times in the past. What do we have in the future? And I'll be deliberately very vague about this scale, but as I see it, there are two broad possibilities. One is that we can go into a resource-limited mode in which population is restricted by the resources available. And that seems to me to be a rather unhappy mode, because if there are those restrictions, then human beings don't have a very good record of resolving these things peaceably. And that, to me, seems to be a rather worrying sort of future. Or there's the sort of utopian mode in which we arrive at some stable population. Maybe it's round about where we are now, maybe it's a bit lower, but we manage to control things in such a way that we're not resource limited. And I labelled that utopia until a couple of days ago. For some reason, how many people have read H.G. Wells' The Time Machine? I can strongly recommend it. I just read it a couple of days ago, and I'm not so sure now about labelling this utopia, because actually it's a fascinating story in which paints a picture of the decline of humanity because of this stable population becomes really, it all gets rather boring and mankind becomes diminished. So let's not get into that, but there are other scenarios. Of course, you know, there's the one beloved of Hollywood, in which something disastrous happens and then we get some post-apocalyptic future, but let's not go into that. So I think this is the background. Okay, I'd like to sort of set the time units, and the time unit I'd like to work on is one Oxford College. I come from a typical Oxford College. It celebrated its 500th anniversary 3 years ago. And I don't want to be thinking of the fact that that college is already, you know, well into its second half, or that Oxford University is well into its second half. I think we like to think of a reasonably long future. And so the unit is, you know, about 500 years. People talking about sustainability over the life of a parliament or a few decades towards the end of the century or whatever, I think are thinking far too short term. 500 years seems to be a sort of reasonable unit to be thinking about for sustainability. So that's the scale on which I'd like to think. And let's just put that in a little bit of context. We're not talking about climate change today. That's a different topic, very interesting topic. But just to be able to set the scale, this is a plot of CO2 concentration in the atmosphere over the last 500,000 years, just about, 400,000 years. And it goes up and down between about 280 parts per million, well, 180 to 280 parts per million. The low points are the ice ages, the higher points are the interglacials. And recently something pretty dramatic has been happening. We're now up at about 390 parts per million. And the 500 years I've talked about, which is quite a long time, is a little bit less than 1 pixel width on the computer. It's less than the thickness of the vertical line. All that vertical line, of course, has happened in the last 50 years. So the vertical line is drawn much too fat. Roughly speaking, the first emergence of anything that remotely resembles a city is about here on this plot. So 500 years is actually an astonishingly short time when you begin to look at what's happening over a slightly longer time scale. That is 500,000 years. That 500,000 years is much less than 1 pixel on this plot, which is the geological time scale. I'm sorry about the fact that it's in Norwegian, but it was the only nice version of this that I could download from the web. Okay, this is the interesting bit of geology, if you like, and that's about 500 million years. And so, you know, our 500,000 years that we were previously interested in is all compressed over here. This is where coal and oil comes from. And we're talking about, you know, using that up within, you know, a millionth of this time scale. It's an interesting thought. That, by the way, is a sort of interesting bit of the Earth's history. That itself is only a little bit of Earth's history, which goes back sort of 4 billion years or so. So I think it is important to look at timescales. So what I like, the message I want you to get there is that in talking about sustainability over 500 years, we're talking about something very, very tiny. We're not talking about a long period. We're talking about a tiny, tiny little period. Okay, let's move on now to resources. There's a lot of talk about renewable resources and non-renewable resources, and I think this is something we just might come to later in discussion. I think it's quite useful to think about which resources are renewable or non-renewable, and if they're non-renewable, are they so abundant that they may as well be renewable, which would put them over here, or are they rather scarce? And we use them for different things. Now, I've divided this roughly into 4 categories. Energy, which is the area that I have most interest, materials that, broadly speaking, we use for construction in its very widest sense. So making aeroplanes, I would call construction. Food and water to sustain us. And then specialised use, the sort of you know, interesting things that are in the heart of mobile phones and things like that. So I don't want to go through every item in this diagram, but I think it's worth just thinking about where the resources that we need sit. So, for instance, if you look at food and water, all of these are renewable. You know, we don't actually eat anything that is non-renewable. We eat animals and plants, and we drink water, and there's plenty of that. It's all recycled. In order for agriculture to work, we need certain materials, modern agriculture to work, we need certain materials like phosphates. They are sitting there much closer to the beginning to get towards the scarcer end of the non-renewable range. Energy, yes, there are renewable technologies, and there are others that are non-renewable. We like to think of nuclear power, perhaps, as a renewable technology, but actually, no, you know, there's not all that much uranium around. It's over here, I would say, in this range. Gas and oil are well over towards this range. Fusion might be over here in the renewable range, but I've put that in red because I'm not sure it's going to work. Certainly doesn't. Nobody's got it to work on a reasonable scale yet. Geothermal, very often thought of as a renewable technology. Actually, it's not. You can think of it as heat mining. It's abundant, but it's not entirely renewable. And I won't go through the rest, but I think it's worth thinking about where things sit on this sort of scale. Okay, what I'd like to do really for the rest of my half of the talk is to talk about energy, which is the area that I'm most interested in. And actually, it's quite interesting, just going back to this, if you can crack the energy problem, you can throw energy at a lot of the other problems. So, for instance, whether or not you regard some of these materials as being scarce or abundant, to a certain extent, depends on how much energy you're prepared to extract them. So energy is central to an awful lot of these problems. This is a plot of UK oil and gas production over the last 20 years. They're on very different scales. One is in millions of tons, the other is in billions of cubic meters, but actually they plot them on the same graph. So the red ones, oil, the blue ones, gas, and the ones with the points on are the actual production from the North Sea and to a lesser extent from the Irish Sea. And the thin red lines are what we've actually used. So if we just concentrate on oil, you can see that we were net exporters of oil for a while. We returned to being importers of oil around about 2005. A little bit of decline of use of oil. I'm not quite sure what's causing this. There is some talk that the price of oil is beginning to have an effect on the market. But here is the amount that we have to import, net import of oil and now of gas. In fact, you can see the bigger gap here on gas. So when people tell you that, oh, you know, we've got lots of North Sea oil and gas left, don't you believe it. Actually, we passed the peak, you know, peak oil, we passed it more than 10 years ago. We are now down to the dregs of North Sea oil and gas. We're reliant increasingly reliant on imports. That's not good for the economy, and it's not good for sustainability of the UK in all sorts of ways. Just before going into that in a little bit more detail, once you start looking at these things, you have to use words in a slightly more specialised way, and there's a certain vocabulary that gets used when talking about resources and reserves of resources, and it's actually different in different sectors of the industry. Without labouring it too much, the oil industry tends to talk about the three P's: proven reserves, probable reserves, and possible reserves. And just going into a little bit more detail, for instance, proven reserves, reasonably certain to be producible using current technology at current prices. Now, that hides an awful lot. Probable reserves, again, current or likely technology, but again at current prices. And then possible, it's getting even a little bit more woolly. In the minerals business, they tend to use slightly different terminology, make a distinction between reserves and resources. And again, a bit of a hierarchy. So reserves can be either proven or probable, a bit like the top two. And then resources can be actually measured resources, this is on a larger scale, or just indicated that they're probably there but haven't actually been quantified in any way. I'm just going to be talking using the oil and gas terminology in the next stage. So here are the data for the UK for oil and gas. Looking at those reserves, and just to show that there are real numbers behind the figures, here are the numbers that can be extracted from, essentially, it's a DTI website. And what we've got is the reserves, and what I've put here is reserves in terms of proven plus probable, the first two Ps, which is fairly common. And we can then look at the production from those reserves. So that's this next line here, and the rate of consumption. And where the numbers are in red, the consumption is greater than the production. So here we are being importers of oil, and here we are importers of gas. Now, you can then do a calculation, which is to work out the reserves to production ratio, which very crudely is how long it would last. Now, everybody said, oh no, the reserves production ratio is quite different, because of course the new reserves will be found, and the rate of production will change, etc. Yes, I know that, but this number gives you a rough idea. The way I like to think about it is, you know, you're on a desert island, you've already walked three times around the desert island, and you've identified all the fruit trees, and you've got a pile of 150 fruits, and you're eating five a day. And you can work out that's going to last you a month. Okay, you might find a few more fruit trees, and you might go down to eating two of these fruits a day, but you know, you can be pretty sure it's not going to last you 2 years. That pile, you might eke it out for 2 months, maybe even three, but order of magnitude, you've got a month left. And that's what this tells us. So order of magnitude, 20 years, coming down to 10, maybe up to 15. Why are the numbers going up here? Because we're actually getting it out a bit slower. Why was there a sudden drop round about the late 1990s in our reserves to production ratio of gas? Because we had this so-called dash for gas, where we converted a lot of electricity production to gas, and effectively it was straightforward. We were burning through our gas quite literally a whole lot faster, and it meant it was going to run out in round about a few years' time. We might eke it out till 2020, but it really is not going to be any longer. So that's where we are on the UK scale. You could look at it a different way. The top line on the graph is the total amount of gas from the UK sector that has been ever found, looking back over 30 years. The black bit is the amount that we've already produced. What you can see is that top line is pretty well static, and here we are, we've got most of it out now. There's a little bit left, but not a huge amount. So on a local scale, we're certainly into scarce resources. How are we on a global scale? There are various different figures for the reserves and the production worldwide of oil, gas, and even more difficult for coal, but looking across the hydrocarbons, different sources for the numbers, but broadly speaking, the reserves to production ratio for coal of the order of 40 years, for gas of the order of 60. For coal, a little bit harder to get exact numbers, but you know, of the order of 150 years. So far as all of these three are concerned, on the 500-year timescale, forget them. You know, they're just not going to be there. So what's the solution? As far as energy is concerned, there are really, I believe, only two solutions. One is nuclear and the other is renewables. I've got nothing against nuclear whatsoever. I just happen to work more in the renewables sector. So what I'd like to do is just say a little bit now about what's happening around the UK in the renewables sector. I have a particular interest in the so-called marine renewables, which is wind, wave, and tidal. That, you know, we're lucky that we live on an island. We're surrounded by water. It's also fairly windy in this part of the world, and so there are a variety of resources that we can exploit there. I'm not actually going to say anything about wave power. That's very exciting in that potentially out there is a huge resource, but nobody has really come up with a realistic way of extracting power from the waves yet. So it's the earliest of it's earlier stage of these three technologies. So I'm just going to say a little bit about wind and about tidal. So this is a plot of wind speed around the UK. And the brighter the colour, the higher the speed. And what you can see is the further you go away from the coast, the higher the wind speeds you get. So it's worth going offshore to get those higher wind speeds. The other thing is that the wind blows more steadily offshore. Essentially, it's less turbulent, and so it's a more useful resource. So there are good reasons to go offshore. What's happening? The early stages of the developments around the UK were fairly small developments, up to about 60 turbines. And where the red arrows are here, these are sites that have already been developed around the UK. Most people are not aware of this because, of course, we don't see windmills offshore. People moan about windmills on their favourite hilltop, but they don't see them offshore, so they don't complain about them. And these sites have already been developed. There are over 400 offshore turbines around the UK, and they have an installed power of about 1.5 gigawatts. Just to put it in context, the average UK consumption of electricity is about 45 gigawatts. So the installed power is a 30th of that, but the wind doesn't blow all the time. Actually, the average power output from all of these is somewhere near 0.5 gigawatt. So at the moment, we're getting about 1% of our power from offshore wind, from these relatively small developments. The future that is seen is that there'll be much larger developments further offshore. The colour scheme isn't very good, but it's these pale pink areas that are the proposed areas for development. Much bigger sites, further offshore, higher wind speeds, actually easier to develop these larger sites. The particular locations are chosen partly because they're areas where there's reasonably shallow water, which makes it slightly easier for the engineering. And the future in about the next 20 years or so is that we should be able to develop about 6,000 turbines offshore, which will generate, in round terms, about 20% of the UK's electrical power. The devices that are being installed at the moment, this is an onshore device, this is a 5-megawatt turbine, but it's actually an onshore installation of the type of device that's used offshore. This is the standard device that is going offshore now, delivering 5 megawatts. The diameter of the rotor is 124 metres. That's it compared to an international football pitch. These are seriously big structures. These rather silly letters that you read in the paper about that wind power's no use, it just delivers, Mickey Mouse amounts of energy. Complete rubbish. These are very big, serious engineering installations that are delivering significant amounts of power and are going to be actually a vital part of our power sources in the future. Because remember, that oil and gas stuff that I was talking about earlier, that's going to have had it in a few years' time. This stuff is there for forever, for all practical purposes. So this is where the future lies, this and nuclear. Just a little bit about tidal stream. There are two ways you can exploit the tides. You can either exploit the fact that the tides make the water go up and down, and you can impound the water at high tide and let it out at low tide. There is one scheme that exploits that in France, and that's what people talk about when they're talking about the Severn barrage. The other possibility is to exploit the velocity of the tides, and that's the area that I'm interested in. And we have extremely good resources, tidal resources, around the UK. A map from the DTI of the resources. The yellow areas are the areas where the peak flow is more than about 2 metres a second. And that's more than enough to be able to develop the tidal resources. And you can see that they're concentrated in various hot spots around the coast. So, for instance, you get high tidal flows in narrow gaps between two bits of land. You get high flows around corners, that the flow is accelerated around the corner. And you get high flows in certain estuaries, of which the Severn estuary is the most famous, where there are resonance effects that amplify the flow of the water. There are some sites that you can't completely categorise, for instance, this area here, that's partly a flow between two bits of land, partly it's a headland effect. So there are multiple effects going on. But there are a number of hot spots around the UK. The one that everybody likes to talk about is the Pentland Firth, where the typical maximum flow is about 4 metres a second. And if you bear in mind that, to a first approximation, the power that you can extract from the tide is proportional to the cube of the velocity, so at 4 metres a second you can get 8 times as much as at 2 metres a second. So that looks extremely attractive. And a lot of the developers are talking about going to use the Pentland Firth. My belief is that they're completely mad, because the Pentland Firth is an unbelievably harsh environment, and actually we need to learn to walk before we run, and exploiting some of these rather less aggressive sites first would be much wiser. Just a little bit about some of the devices that are being suggested to exploit those flows. There's devices that look a bit like underwater windmills. There are devices that look, again, a bit like windmills, but have some sort of ducting system to channel the flow through the turbine, accelerate the flow through the turbine. One of the projects that we're undertaking in Oxford actually is looking at whether it's worth doing this, and actually it's not. So, which has been a bit of a disappointment to some developers. Then there are other devices. I'm actually involved in the development of this device, which is called the Transverse Horizontal Axis Water Turbine. This is a device specifically devised to work at very large scale in slightly lower velocities. But I'll not go into that in more detail. There are devices which, rather than rotating, flap up and down in some way. A few people are promoting those. I'm not entirely convinced they're going to work. And there are some what can only be classified as weird and wonderful devices, which I'm quite certain won't work. Ultimately, if you're working offshore, you've got to keep things pretty simple. And I think the candidate devices that will end up being successful are the simple propeller-type devices and, I hope, the simple transverse flow device. Just because a resource is renewable doesn't mean that it isn't scarce. And if we just go back here, you can see that you can't just put tidal devices everywhere. There are only certain areas where you can exploit the tides, and we have to understand how to do that. And so we've been carrying out research on what happens when you actually put the devices in the water, how that affects the flow. And here you can see a fairly idealized picture of the accelerated flow past a headland. So I hope you can just see the little arrows. And you can see the highest flow is just off this headland. So we get this acceleration effect. So here's a good place to put the devices. And then here's a model of what happens if you do put devices in this area and start extracting energy. Well, of course, what happens is you slow the flow down through the devices. And what does the flow do? It just goes round the sides. So that's not much use. So what you have to do is understand the interaction of the device with the flow. You can't just assume that the flow will keep going through there once you start taking energy out. And importantly, you've got to understand that at various different scales. You can't just look in detail at a small problem. So we're now moving on to building larger models. This is just the preliminary numerical model of the Severn estuary, which will be used to look at the interactions between extracting energy using tidal stream devices in certain parts of the estuary with what could happen elsewhere. So, for instance, the candidate sites where you'd want to put tidal stream devices are mainly fairly well downstream here, whereas the candidate sites for a barrier are well upstream. You might want to do both, but you would certainly want to know how they interact. So we need to understand this scarce resource. Even though it's a renewable resource, it's still a scarce resource that we need to understand. I'm not at all an expert on the mineral side of scarce resources, but I thought I'd just give a very quick take before handing on to Tony to talk in more detail. There was a fairly high-profile article in New Scientist about 3 years or so ago, which highlighted various minerals that are getting scarce. And essentially what this plot shows is these bars are showing, in fact, straightforwardly, the reserves to production ratio, just as for the oil or gas. And the length of the bar depends on how long we've got. Now, what you can't see there is the scale. The scale is logarithmic. This is 10 years, this is 100 years, this is 1,000 years. And what you can see is there are quite a number of important materials where the sort of time scale that we've got on the reserves to production ratio is of the order of a few decades. So we have similar problems with minerals as we have with oil and gas. Now, there are some serious issues that Tony will go into about actually why this might be a very distorted view, and that's particularly related to what you actually call the resource. But, you know, it just begins to build up the picture that maybe there are other materials that we need to worry about how long they're going to last. Perhaps more importantly, it's not just about how much there is, but where they are. So you won't be able to see these different the captions on the different materials, but just look at the distribution of some of these important minerals and note the virtual absence of them in Europe. You know, they come from places that maybe we don't exert huge amounts of influence over, and places that may not necessarily be the most reliable source of supply. In particular, you know, there's very large resources in China. The fact that these are appearing here may be to do with the economics of what we're choosing to exploit rather than what is there. But the distribution around the world is important. Let me just pick out a couple of examples, well, one example in particular. For instance, phosphates needed, essential for modern agriculture. And these are materials that effectively we use and throw away. They're not recyclable in any way. The reserves to production ratio there is such that it looks as if, you know, we've got of the order of multiple decades supply of that. Where does it come from? Mostly at the moment, you know, Morocco and China. That's what our agriculture depends on, what Western agriculture depends on. Interesting thought. The EU recently did a review on some key materials that are used, source materials. And then in the back of that report, it's a very interesting table of many different minerals and other materials that we need, and a percentage of how much of those is imported into the EU and where they come from. Now, I've not copied the whole table. I just picked out a few lines from the table of some surprising numbers. And, you know, there's a lot of these materials where we're importing either all of it or most of it to the EU, that's used in the EU, is imported. Let's just look at one or two of them. You know, cobalt. We import everything on cobalt. 41% comes from the Democratic Republic of Congo, not noted for stability. Some other bizarre ones. Limestone. Why are we importing two-thirds of the limestone from China? It's very odd. You know, there's sustainability issues around that. Magnesium, 100% imported, 56% of it from China. Some of these, I think, are rather startling figures. Rare earth elements, mostly used in the high-tech industry, all imported, 90%, 97% from China. I'm not an expert in this area. These sorts of numbers frighten me a bit, so that's why I asked Tony to come along as well and tell us a bit more about it.
I'm very pleased to be here, and I'll try and explain a little bit about minerals and metals that I've picked up over the sort of 30 years that I've been in the industry. And what I really want to point out through the talk, and not necessarily in a sequential way, but there definitely is an increase in the demand that we have. Some materials we describe as strategic, important, critical, whatever you want to call it. And then say, well, are we running out of those supplies? I'll investigate that question. Make the connections to environmental management, the problems of resource constraints and nationalism, and perhaps suggest some ways forward. And I will try and do that quickly because we want to have some time for discussion afterwards. So, okay, over early hominids didn't have a very big footprint on the ground. Whatever they had at the start of the year, they finished at the end of the year, and there weren't very many of them either. But now, modern Western, we use a lot more inputs into our existence, and these are numbers per capita. So I'm not suggesting that the modern Westerner excretes 3 tons a year of material, but we do waste and we throw away material of those sorts of volumes. How does that look in a different form? As Professor Houlsby showed there, this is a more sort of traditional split of materials into biomass, fuels, industrial minerals, and metallic minerals. And this is the history from 1980 up to approximately present time, from about 38 billion tonnes per year up to 60 in that 25 years. And projections over the next 25 years are further increases in all of those materials. So demand is definitely increasing. This is another schematic produced. These last three slides are all from an Austrian organisation called CIRI. And if anybody wants any information on the information in the programme at the end, contact me and I'll try and make the connections for you. But this is really another demonstration, not over time scale, as Professor Houlsby said, but geographically. This is from 2000, but you know, you might find that it's interesting that Oceania has the biggest consumption per capita, but we must remember that in Australia they extract a lot of materials, so if you divide the materials extracted by the people there, it becomes quite high. So they don't necessarily consume all that internally, some of that's shipped to the rest of the world. But there is an imbalance over time and an imbalance geographically. If we look at how that changes on a graphical form, here is the world average. Here is Oceania. Here is Asia and Africa. So as the level of affluence increases there, obviously with the large populations, that's going to shift the world average up significantly. This is another sort of representation of the same sort of thing, which this is a Japanese presentation of the periodic table. It's the total materials required per ton of element. So to produce iron, we move the materials moved to produce that is about 8 tons, whereas for gold it's about 1 million tons. So those are the relative material rucksacks per element. If we look at that in a slightly different way, this axis is how much we produce. So the only element that we produce a billion tons of, the only metallic element we produce a billion tons of is iron or steel. But we only process 8 tons per ton of that material. So it's a big volume, but a relatively small tonnage of material moved. Whereas gold, where we said it was a million tons per ton produced, but we only produce 1,000 tons a year. So that's an interesting presentation for the different elements. You'll probably guess by my presentation that I'm a metallurgist or a material scientist by origin, so I am a little bit over-focused on metals, but that's because Professor Houlsby did the fuel stuff before, so I feel justified in doing that. And metals or materials are an important part in social development, and if we look at how society's progressed, initially, of course, we measured this in terms of improvements in materials and improvements that these materials gave us, usually militarily, over people that had the previous technologies. It's interesting that one of iron's advantages is that there are iron deposits over most parts of the world, so actually availability of iron wasn't a limiting factor in development of many economies. If we go back in the timescale, not quite the geological eras that Professor Houlsby was talking about, but to Roman times, perhaps they were the first people to come to Britain in terms of looking for resources. They probably came looking for copper, but by the time they got to Wales, the Phoenicians had taken most of the copper away, so they ended up, actually, lead was a principal export from Britain for the Roman Empire. So strategic metals, strategic materials, what are they? Well, they're things that are important either for military or economic reasons, or a combination of both. They're materials that are not readily available in your own backyard, and there may be concerns over the security of supply. And why might shortages occur? Because, as we saw earlier, as the population increases, the level of affluence increases, there's a twofold pressure on the volumes of materials that are used. And also, as political blocs become looking at each other's behaviour, and as China has become a stronger economy, people are beginning to say, well, will primary supplies be limited? Will there be an equal, equitable distribution of resources? And may there be national or corporate control of certain resources? So the EU said, OK, let's have a look at the materials that we need in the European Union. And they produced quite a large report in 2010, which is well worth looking at. It's a big source of information. And they defined what they called 14 materials, but that's if you count platinum group metals and rare earth metals as one. They're not, but... So there are 14 types of material that they classified as critical. How do they define critical? It was a combination of economic importance and supply risk. And we don't really have time to go into how they define those. It's in the report. But these are the 14, and these are sort of fairly arbitrary demarcation of those materials. So rare earths have been in the news a lot because there's a very high supply risk. Economic importance is high, not so high, but the supply risk is high. Something like niobium, there's only a couple of places in the world, primarily most of it is actually coming from Brazil. So there's a supply issue and it's relatively high economic importance. So the EU has woken up, as Professor Houlsby said, to the reliance on external supplies for important materials. But also they realised, well, if there are other economies using these materials, there's going to be price increases, and possibly that will impact on the viability of European industry. What I would like to just have as say as an aside here is, we don't necessarily know the value of these materials to the European economy, because we measure the ore or the metals that we import, but we don't measure the invisible imports of these materials. There are rare earth metals in the phones, in the magnets, in other imports that we have that we don't actually take account of. And you'll see a little bit further in my presentation where they end up. So, you see, when you steal information from other people, you often end up having the same information on the slide. But for me, there'll be a little bit of a thread through my talk. Copper is a metal that I use as an example, not because it's a critical material, but because we've had a long experience, 7,000 years of producing it. And on this list here, as Professor Houlsby said, it measures the resource base and the annual consumption, current annual consumption, and projects lifetimes. And for copper, I believe, if they project with the current consumption rate, it's something like 68 years. But if average global consumption increased to half of the rate of American consumption, then it reduces down to about 18 years. But I think we don't have a problem of running out of materials, and I'll try and explain why in the next few slides. This is the reserve base. So people measure reserves and reserve base. Reserves are what is economic to be exploited now, and they measure it and they infer it from their programs. But it's not in the economic interests of a commercial company to explore more than they need for the next few years. So they will never actually declare more than a certain amount of reserves. As long as they declare what the information that they need to show their stakeholders that they are viable for the next couple of years, then they don't need to prove more materials. And as Professor Houlsby said, if the price starts to go up, material that was sub-economic becomes economic, so the reserves increase. And if we look for other materials, then we find that there's more materials come into. So if you look back historically over the reserve base, although we keep producing more and more materials, usually the amount of years' reserves available remains the same. Now, there's a difference there between oil and fossil fuels and minerals, and I'll explain a couple of reasons why I think that is. This is a typical distribution for different types of minerals. In the early exploration, we've used the high-grade ores. We take the highest grade, the lowest, where we can make the most money, and where simple technology can produce viable production. But as those reserves get worked out, we exploit lower and lower grade ores. And as you work those lower and lower grade ores, there is more and more of it available, but it's much harder to extract, and it's much more costly in terms of energy and total material required. So it's not an availability problem, but it's the cost in terms of environment, energy, that will continue to increase. And I can illustrate this with copper. So copper production has gone up from about 5 million to 15 million tonnes a year in the last 70 years. And the grade of copper exploited was about 2% in 1930. When I studied extractive metallurgy, it was about 1%, and everybody said, oh, you can't go below 1%. Now they're extracting less than 0.5% copper. What's that mean? In terms of the volume of material extracted, it's got to go up, because although the grade's been going down, we're producing more and more. So we have to shift more and more material. That's just the copper ore shown there. It's also the overburden and all the other material associated with the mine. This is an illustration of the actual grades of copper produced over the last... this was in 2009. This is underground mines, where you can see grades as high as 3%, probably down to about 1%, or even slightly lower. These are open pit mines, which are more like quarries and can be exploited in bulk. And you can see they're being exploited at copper levels of down to 0.25%. So that's a combination of economies of scale and low-cost extraction techniques has meant that the reserve base, the available material, has increased. So I'd now like to say, well, if we have a constraint on supply of materials, what can we do to get over that? We can identify new deposits, explore for more materials. And funny enough, we haven't done much exploration in the UK in the last 50 years because we've gone elsewhere to look for minerals. So there's parts of the UK that are not very well defined in terms of exploration. We can try and find alternates. If rare earths become expensive, can we use something else? Or we can try and look at recovering more of the materials that we use. And in all those processes, the knowledge of science of material science is critical. I'm going to quickly go through each of those phases. New resources. There's plans to open a new tungsten mine in Hemerdon. It's not a British company that's developing it, it's an Australian company. But it's going to be of the sort of scale that would be a world-class mine. So probably 10 to 15% of the world's tungsten requirement would be produced from that mine. So that would reduce the European reliance on export on imports from places like China. The question is, will we give planning permission to do it? Will we have the technology and the resources to do it? Material is there if we choose to extract it. Cornwall traditionally has produced tin and copper, and as the prices of tin and copper go up, there are redevelopment and re-examinations of those deposits and even of the ancient deposits at Anglesey. And some of these more exotic elements, like lithium, rare earths and so on, we didn't look for those before, but often they're associated with some of these other elements. And so there are examinations in the southwest now to look at recovering some of these materials. Substitution, it's a great idea. If you haven't got any cobalt, chuck something else in. But it isn't quite that simple because the cobalt has special properties that mean why you chose it in the first place. So if you're going to look for substitutes, you have to have a 5 or 10 or 15 year research program to do that. People like the Japanese have the foresight to do that. Unfortunately, in Europe, we don't have that sort of timescale thinking. Recovering and recycling. If you take one thing away from this presentation that I'm doing, I hope you understand the difference between minerals and fossil fuels. When we use metals, we don't consume them. We utilise them. Because at the end of life, most of that material is available to recover and reuse. If we design the product well in the first place and we manage it well at the end of life, a high proportion of the material is available. And it's a strong reason for us to reuse that, because to reprocess it uses a lot less energy than primary production. And I'll emphasise that point as we go further. So let's try and maximise the recovery and recycling. This is I believe it's a German guy, or could be Austrian, but this diagram I've stolen from him. Metals like gold, when you use gold, you don't degrade it, and it's there to be recycled and reused. Steel, okay, maybe surface you have a bit of corrosion, so you lose some. But of the 1.4 billion tons of steel produced in the world every year, nearly 50% of it is from scrap. So already we're having a high recycling rate for steel. Some metals, like magnesium or zinc, there may be a higher consumption rate during the utilisation phase. But what we've done up to now is we haven't recovered these materials to recycle them. We've got to do that better. This is if you like, what I talked about, supply chain. Ore coming in, processed into metal, goes into fabrication, goes into use, and the end of use, it's either discarded, or if we do it better, it's recycled here. We can recycle it in the use phase. We can have a refurbishment and reuse of a component, and we can recycle during the fabrication stage. If we maximise all of these, we can minimise this, and so we minimise the requirement for this. This is a publication from the International Resource Panel. Tom Gradell, a professor from Yale, has been working in this area for many years. If you look at this key here, these metals, 50% of production is from recycling. Now, probably the common thing between them is that these tend to be the older metals, the metals that have been around for some time. If you look at these metals that are recycled less than 1%, they're things like tantalum, some of the rare earths. They've been in use in society for a lot less time. So there's a less material in stock, and we've got less practice at how to recover and reuse them. We have to be smarter how we design so that we can do that better. Copper. This is the volume of copper production in green, increasing up to 16 million tonnes from the year 1900. This is the actual price, and this is the 1998 adjusted price. So you can see, for most metals, actually the price of metal has gone down over time. If you look at it in real terms, it's only in the last couple of years where we've had this economic boom that the price has actually increased above the 1998 value. And that's typical for most metals. And the point I want to make here on this slide, since although we've been producing copper for 7,000 years, probably in the first for the first 6,900 tonnes of a year, we produced a total of 10 million tonnes. Since then, we produced 550 million tonnes, and for the first 50 years of the last century, we averaged 1.4 million tonnes a year. In the next 50 years, 6.5 million tonnes per year, and from 2000 to 2009, nearly 15. Projected demand, if we carry on the trend, is to be 30 to 45 million tonnes a year. So why should we be concerned about this? If the UK doesn't invest in geological mining and mineral processing knowledge, we will lose that. We've lost a lot of metal production capability and reduced capacity in other areas. I see Rio Tinto Zinc are planning or to sell the aluminium smelter in Northumberland now, after having closed the one at Anglesey. So there are reductions in the material produced in the UK. Now, if we do that because of economic reasons, it's one thing. If we do it for environmental legislation reasons, and then that metal is produced somewhere else, but with worse emissions, then it's not really very sensible. And materials have a high added value. If you look at the actual value of the materials themselves, the ores and the metals, maybe not. But they may be a low part of the total economic turnover. But if you look at what they enable, the products they enable, the aerospace, the high-tech applications, then, and here's an example for nickel. I'm sort of rushing through here to give us a little bit of time to talk at the end. But my feeling is, unless we address all parts of that supply chain that I described earlier, we can't just focus on one element of it. It's not just a question of materials availability. We have to know how to process it and how to manage it and how to design it. We have to look at the whole life cycle. And particularly so if we're going to have a green economy, because if we're going to build wilderness everywhere with gearless drives, we're going to use a lot of rare earth metal, so we better be sure that we can have access to those. Why I want to look at recycling is shown on this graph here. If you look at the amount of energy taken to produce primary metal to secondary metal, you can see the differences here for many metals and even here for some non-metals. If we penalise a primary producer for producing aluminium based on their CO2 emissions, we should give credit to a secondary producer who is producing aluminium at a much lower CO2 emission. If we do that, we will encourage recycling and bring down the average emissions for that production of that metal. you've all probably seen, know about life cycle thinking, but if we need to consider life cycle thinking through the design phase of everything we produce. We have to design things with the idea of making recycling possible at the end of life. If we do that, we have a chance of reducing our carbon footprint for all the products that we produce. And just quickly, I want to show again a difference between approach between Japan and Europe. This is a traditional method of processing battery scrap, where you can recover certain parts of the materials, but only a relatively small amount. If you invest in research, you've got the potential to develop a wider range of materials and recover a higher proportion of those materials. And I think Europe has to think of its secondary sources as an important part of their economy. We need to go from a economic base where we process materials once and dispose of it, recycling only a limited amount, to one where we recycle and reuse most materials, and we only produce primary material to replace the small amount that we can't reuse or recycle. And this is nearly the end now. It's not just a technical answer to this, and as I understand the purpose of these discussions is to look at interdisciplinary opportunities and ideas. If we don't begin to change the way we think about society and think about the way we handle and process and use materials, I mean, how many of us really want to use a reconditioned piece of equipment? We want to buy the latest thing, we want to buy the newest thing. But if we really want to reduce our carbon footprint, we have to change the way of thinking and have a long systems and materials that last for extended life that are capable of being reused or repaired, upgraded, without just throwing it away or buying the latest phone because it's got a few more jingles on it. And this is the last slide. So if we don't do that, this is from a United Nations publication. The pressures of increased population, natural disasters, environmental degradation, and these other factors are all likely to lead to environmentally induced conflict. And I think that's the same sort of conclusion as Professor Houlsby came to earlier, because of unequal access to the resources across the globe. I'm sorry that I had to rush through that a bit, but my contact details are there. I'm very happy to sort of continue the discussions and either electronically or today. Unfortunately, I have to shoot off to a meeting in London this evening at just after 5, so, but I'm perfectly happy to take questions now. Thank you very much. Thank you.